dear children, namaste to all of you and welcome to the next session of our BioBytes in 15 minute series for class 10 ICSE. This is Ambika, your biology master teacher, right here on the super duper amazing platform of Vedantu. So guys, let us get started. Today, the topic that we are going to be discussing in BioBytes is sense organs. Of course, not every detail of the sense organs, but what you mainly need to know. I think the parts of the eye, mechanism of vision, parts of the ear and the mechanism of hearing are good enough to make you confident to face these topics in your exams. Of course, defects and all of them are also part of it, but you can check them out on our main playlist where we have discussed all of those in detail. Right, children? Okay, and remember, stay humble, work hard, and always, always be kind. Okay? Things will be filled with positivity around you. And also, talking about Vedantu's amazing courses which you can benefit from, children, please do remember to visit the link in the description box below and the pinned comment. And the coupon code that you can apply is AMBPRO to avail all of them at the best possible rates, because exam season and now is the time for you to make a decision on this. Okay. So, oh yes, by the way, before I forget, NTSE stage 2 courses have also been launched by Vedantu. Those of you who are NTSE aspirants, please do register for this as well if you haven't done it yet. This is in fact already started on the 17th of December, and this will go on till the 13th of Feb 2021, Monday through Saturday. So to check out more details and to register right away before it gets late, check out the link in the description box below. And make sure you do before it gets late. All right, children. So yes, of course, coming to the topic, sense organs. Of course, sense organs, the major sense organs are the organs of your vision, hearing, nose or smell, the sense of smell, touch and taste. Okay, these are the major five sense organs that we have. And the main one we are going to be discussing today first is eye. Of course, we'll be discussing the ear also, but the eye starts here. Okay, this is what your eye looks like from a side view. The structure of the eye, the structure of the eyeball looks from a side view. The conjunctiva is actually the outermost thin covering present over the entire front part of your eye. So where is it actually? If you actually fold up your eyelid a little bit, don't do that if you have very sensitive eyes, you would see a red portion, right? That is actually what the conjunctiva is. But over the cornea, which is like in front of your eyes, what you see here, you don't see it turn red, right? That is because it is reduced to a thin layer, a thin transparent layer over here, okay? But the conjunctiva is the outermost covering which you see here, all right? Right, so now coming to the remaining parts, the structure of the eye. I know this diagram looks a little complex for many of you, but it's very simple once you learn the parts. So to make it easier for you, this diagram is given here. And apart from it, I've also made a table with the name of each of these parts and the role or description of each of it to make it visible to you in a revisable form to you at one glance. Okay, so starting with the cornea, of course, we've seen what the conjunctiva is. And apart from that, there's the cornea, which is like this, the thin transparent layer covering the bulging portion of the eye in front. Okay, and then the major parts you need to know are the pupil and the iris. Now iris, remember children, iris is the portion which you see like this. The colored portion of your eye is what the iris is, and you would see a thin hole in the middle of it this way, which can either expand in diameter or reduce according to the amount of light your eye is exposed to. So this portion is the iris, which is the colored part. It could be blue, black, brown, green, according to what you inherit from your parents. And this opening in the middle of it, through which light can enter, is called the pupil. The pupil can constrict or dilate as needed. Okay, if you are in dim light, for example, the pupil would be wider in diameter so that more light can enter it. And if you're exposed to really bright light, it reduces in diameter so that only a certain amount of light enters into your eye. Okay, so this is what the iris and the pupil are. And of course, there is the lens, which is a biconcave lens, as you know. And apart from this, there are two chambers which we can divide our eye into: the aqueous chamber, which is filled with aqueous humor, and the vitreous chamber, which is filled with a thicker substance, which is called the vitreous chamber, which is filled with a thicker substance called vitreous humor. Okay, so the aqueous chamber and the vitreous chamber filled with the respective secretions, or rather this the respective fluids. Aqueous chamber, it's more a fluidy secretion that it has, which is why it's called aqueous in the first place. Vitreous is more jelly like, thicker in consistency. Okay, and what you need to know apart from this are the sclerotic layer, the choroid layer, and the retinal layer. These three layers, okay? The outer sclerotic layer, or the sclera, which is actually the white of your eye, okay? And inner to that is the choroid layer, which is richly supplied with blood vessels. And the innermost is the layer called the retina, which is the area where images would be formed in your eye, okay? So that is the retina, and that contains the photoreceptor cells, the rods and cones, which help in vision. Okay, so rods help in identifying whether you're in dim light or in bright light. Cones help you with color vision. Okay, so I will just write that as well, rods and cones, something again that you have to know. And apart from this, the area with maximum vision is called fovea centralis. It's called the yellow spot where maximum number of cone cells are concentrated, area of brightest vision. And there is another spot which is called the blind spot, where there are no photoreceptor cells at all, but rather that's the area where all the fibers, the nerve fibers from the retina, would come together to form a bundle and leave your eye, forming the optic nerve to transmit signals to your brain. So this is what the structure of your eye is like. Okay, and of course additionally you need to know about the ciliary muscles and the suspensory ligaments, which help in expanding or contracting the lens of your eye in order to help with distant vision or nearby vision respectively. All right, okay, so here it is. Everything, all of this is just there to help you understand, children, when you do a very quick revision. So I think we've discussed all of this: the outer sclerotic layer, middle choroid layer, and the inner retinal layer. All right, and of course, once again, the image to you in another view, basically the other view. Instead of seeing it from this side, we start here from the cornea on the right side and backward. That's about it. Pretty much the same thing explained to you. And of course, the table that I was telling you about, all the parts of the eye, the major parts of the eye, which you need to know, and their role or description, which you need to know about. Okay, so all of this will definitely help you identify, or rather give you a very, very quick revision at one glance. Right, children, now coming to how do we see. As you can see here, light rays enter into your eyes. They pass through the cornea first. Light rays get bent when they pass through the cornea. And the next bending occurs when they pass through the lens, the biconvex lens. Okay, so here it is. It passes through and ultimately converges on the retina. And retina is where a real inverted image would be formed. Okay, so real inverted image would be formed, and those would be sent, the messages of those would be sent through the optic nerves to your brain, which perceives all this and is able to identify the object in its upright form. Okay, so this is what the mechanism of vision is like. So when you look at a distant object, what would happen is the ciliary muscles would relax, causing the lens to become taut and flat. Okay, rather when you look at a nearby object, the ciliary muscles would contract, releasing tension on the fibers, allowing the lens to become more spherical. Okay, so this is what happens. Close would mean more curved, the lenses, the biconvex lens. Okay, right. So that is about the human eye. Now coming to the human ear. Of course, your ear is the organ which helps you in hearing and body balance. You can divide the ear into three major parts: the external ear, the middle ear, and the internal ear. The external ear, or the outer ear, is comprised of the pinna and the ear canal. That's it. And the ear canal leads to the eardrum, or the tympanic membrane. I'll just write here tympanum. Okay? The tympanum basically separates your middle ear from the external ear. In the middle ear, the major parts are the three ear ossicles, the the malleus, incus, and the stapes. And apart from this, there is the Eustachian tube, which connects your middle ear to your throat. Super duper important. And in the inner ear also, there are certain specialized structures, especially the semicircular canals and the cochlea, which are filled with fluid, perilymph and endolymph. I will be telling you more about that, and they help in hearing. Okay, and from there is the auditory nerve as well. The external ear, starting with, consists of the projecting part, which you see outside, called the pinna or the auricle, and that leads into a passage called the auditory canal or the ear canal. This leads to the eardrum, which is also called the tympanum. Okay, this is about the external ear. This is how sound waves are perceived by your external ear and passed on to your middle ear. So when sound waves are received by the external ear, it passes on inside and vibrates your eardrum ultimately. Okay, right. Now coming to the middle ear. It consists of three tiny bones, which are the smallest in your body. We also call them ear ossicles. According to their shape, they are also nicknamed hammer, anvil, and stirrup, respectively. Okay, so apart from this, there is the Eustachian tube, as I have told you, connects the cavity of the middle ear with the throat. Children, malleus, incus, and stapes, you need to know them in this order itself. Malleus, incus, and stapes. After the eardrum, these are the three parts inside your ear. Okay, you need to know this order because it's very important. Now, yes, this is what it is. The handle of the hammer bone or the malleus is connected to the inner surface of the eardrum, as you can see here, right? And its opposite end, the malleus's opposite end, is connected to the next bone, the anvil. And the anvil is connected to the stirrup, which is right here. And the stirrup is connected to a membrane-bound structure called the oval window. And that leads to the inner ear. This is how your middle ear is designed. This is it. Okay, so oval window, and apart from that, there is another opening called the round window, which is also covered by a thin membrane, and it connects the middle and the inner ear as well. Okay, right, so that's about the external ear and the middle ear. Coming to the inner ear, it's also called membranous labyrinth because of its maze-like structure, and it's got three major parts: the cochlea, the snail-like structure called the cochlea, the semicircular canals, there are three semicircular canals, and the vestibules. Okay, so the cochlea, as you can see, it's a highly coiled structure, 2.5 turns or so that it has, and it's filled with fluid which helps transmit vibrations of the sound vibrations further down into your ear. Okay, so now coming to the mechanism of hearing. So we've spoken about external, middle, and the inner ear, and here is the mechanism of hearing. Of course, the sound waves are perceived by your outer ear or the external ear, and this passes on through the external auditory canal. It vibrates the tympanic membrane or the eardrum, and when that vibrates, that in turn passes on the vibration to the bone adjoining, which is the malleus. When the malleus vibrates, the next bone vibrates, which is the incus, and then the next bone vibrates, which is the stapes. And from there, the vibrations would be passed on through the oval window to the inner ear. Now, children, it's very important to note that the vibrations or the sound waves would be amplified by about 20 times or so from the stapes when it passes on to the inner ear. The main reason is because the inner ear is filled with fluid. And for the sound waves to be heard well enough, or rather be perceived well enough in a fluidy medium, it has to be amplified as compared to what you would need in air. Imagine me talking to you like this on land, like what I'm doing right now, and compare it with what it would be like if I spoke to you in the same volume underwater. Obviously, I would have to amplify my voice using some means, right? Because under a watery medium, that is required. It's a completely different medium. So this is why that amplification occurs. And inside your inner ear, the organ of Corti, which would be the organ of hearing, the part which helps you hear, all the sound waves would be perceived, and from there the auditory nerves would transmit the impulses, the sound wave impulses, and transmit them to the brain. So this is it. This is a flow chart which helps you understand the mechanism of hearing at one glance, starting with the pinna, and then vibration striking on the eardrum, which vibrates the ear ossicles, transmitting the vibrations to the oval window, and then the fluid in the cochlear canal receives this, stimulates the sensory cells in the organ of Corti, and these get picked up by the auditory nerves sent to the brain, right? So that's about it. The entire session in a bite size for you. Human body has five major sense organs, which are mentioned here. Where do you find your eyes? Located in orbits, which are sockets in your skull. There are sensory receptors of the eyes, which are rods and cones, located in the retina. Cones, which help in color vision. Rods, which help in normal vision, to help you identify whether it's dim light or bright light, that you're in darkness or lightness that you're in. And then your ears help in balancing your body, and also helps you hear. Okay. And then the outer ear is made up of pinna and the ear canal. Middle ear includes the ossicles, and the cochlea, which is part of your inner ear, is filled with two fluids, endolymph and perilymph. And inside that, there is the sensory receptor, the organ of Corti, which contains hair cells, and the nerve receptors, which help you hear. It gets transmitted to the brain and you are able to identify sounds. So that's about it, children. We are done with the eye and the ear, the major sense organs, in just a few minutes. If you wish to know them in detail, please check out the main playlist, as I have already told you. But children, do not forget to click on the like button in case you haven't done it yet, because I'm sure this is going to help you very, very much in your last minute revisions. And share it with all your ICSE class 10 friends, because sharing is caring, definitely. And subscribe to the channel Vedantu 9th and 10th English if you haven't done it yet, because we have a lot more coming up for you in the days and months to come. We will never stop working hard for you. Okay, children. And that's about it from my side. Until we meet again, take care, stay happy, and stay healthy. Bye-bye.